The memorial was established by the people of New South Wales who decided to put together this magnificent memorial to honour those that were lost in the Gallipoli campaign. The fund to establish the memorial was created in 1916 on the first anniversary of the landing at Gallipoli. Rainer Hoff was born on the Isle of Man. His best known works are the figures on the interior and exterior of the Anzac Memorial in Sydney's Hyde Park. On the Gallipoli Peninsula, there are many sites that have their own history, and therefore our plan was to ensure the stories at those sites would be told to our travellers by experienced historians and told on the ground where that action had taken place. It was at Anzac Cove where the legend was set in place, as on the 25th of April 1915, the Anzacs landed on that beach, forever known as Anzac Cove. Following his viewing of the air photographs taken by Air Commodore Sampson and his team of flyers, General Bird would change the landing site to the north, to Anzac Cove and North Beach, and also planned a night landing. Due to his astute revised plan, the Anzacs were able to make it ashore with minimal casualties. Men pushed forward, aiming to take the heights and thereby dominate the narrows of the Dardanelles. By 0800, 8,000 men were ashore, and although there was great confusion everywhere, it was clear that the Turks were on the run. The horrors of facing bullets for the first time were now over, and an exuberant relief began to spread amongst the Anzac troops. As the officers gathered their men for a more coherent advance, the Allies suffered a cruel blow. By accident, one junior Turkish commander, a tactical genius, took command of the defence and assigned the Anzacs to a beachhead with only 2,500 metres depth for the rest of the campaign. He was Mustafa Kemal.
V Beach was made for defence. The Turkish defenders there held up 10 times their number for the day. The British soldiers that made it ashore alive were trapped there until nightfall.
The landings around the toe of the peninsula were a victim of poor planning and leadership. It was not the leaders on the ground who were at fault, but the commander, General Hunter Weston. There were successful landings at Y Beach, 6 kilometres up the coast from Helles, S Beach, north of Morto Bay, and X Beach, 3 kilometres north of Helles, that, if supported by General Hunter Weston, would have had Krithia and Achababa in British hands by nightfall. This did not happen, and the other landings on W and V beaches did gain a foothold ashore, but at a terrible cost. As a testament to the gallantry of the men landing at W Beach, General Hamilton ordered this beach to be known as Lancashire Landing.
On the 25th of April 1915, early in the morning at W Beach, later called Lancashire Landing, the 1st Battalion, the Lancashire Fusiliers, landed. By 10 a.m. that morning, 55% of the battalion was dead or wounded, and they had won 6 Victoria Crosses before breakfast.
Throughout the operation, the cove provided some shelter for men, animals and equipment in what was otherwise a very dangerous place. So much so that the cove became a congested tangle right from the outset. It was the first sight most men had of Gallipoli, and when the last boats pushed off on the evening of the 20th of December, it was the last glimpse the Anzacs had of those fatal shores.
There was numerous little sites of last stands out there where small groups of men bumped the Ottoman reserve or the Ottoman division coming up, and Bean located a lot of those sites in 1919. Some bones, some fired cartridge cases, someone's last stand. But Blackburn and Roban got back over and they saw another group of their blokes led by a man named Noel Loutet, who was a platoon commander. They joined up with those guys, but even Loutet with his 20 or so men, he had a form body of people, but they were still unable to match what was coming. So they fell back in and consolidated on that line that started to form very quickly. And then as progressive soldiers landed, instead of conforming to the plan, they just started pushing them into the front line anywhere they could fit them.
The first casualty clearing station was established at North Beach. Initially, there was nowhere to put the rows of dead and wounded, and rows of bodies were laid out along the beach.
Australians tend to see the Gallipoli campaign as purely an Australian affair, but the reality is that our casualties represented only 20% of total Allied casualties on that campaign.
The Lone Pine and the Neck actions were actually major feints in support of Birdwood's action to break out of the Anzac Bridgehead by night and assault Chunuk Bear and the crests of the Sari Bear Range. The concurrent landings at Suvla Bay would have the soldiers quickly join up with the new Anzac Bridgehead. The landings at Suvla Bay did not push onto the heights to then join up with the Anzacs, who had conducted their assaults as planned. In a campaign marked by mismanagement and bravery, the operation stands at the head of both categories. The light horsemen charged at the Neck in repeated waves and were massacred. Their heroism is unimaginable. Equally, the orders which sent them in resulted in that dreadful outcome.
At Lone Pine, the Australians won 7 Victoria Crosses. 4 of those Victoria Crosses were won by one unit alone, the 7th Battalion.
The successful attack at Lone Pine was a desperate assault, made along a front of only 220 metres against strongly built trenches. Much of the fighting was hand-to-hand, and lasted until the last of the Turkish counterattacks on the 9th of August. But from the 6th of August, Lone Pine remained in Australian hands. This was the only success of the campaign.
The Australian veterans who survived Lone Pine always compared subsequent battles on the Western Front with the ferocity of Lone Pine by saying the battle was nearly as bad as Lone Pine. Here at Lone Pine, it's not as significant as some of the journalists would like us to appear, because it was only either a feint, or I prefer to call it, was a ferocious diversionary attack, and in fact it was successful, the only one we had. But the main action was up at Chunuk Bear. They were trying to take Chunuk Bear. So that was the aim of the game. Divert the Turkish troops from Chunuk Bear down here. They hoped to bring down one Turkish brigade. They in fact brought down three. So from that point of view, that was the aim. Very successful, which was rather uncharacteristic in 1915. It was well planned by the commanders. There was another little surprise that in effect, and I don't know, with Australians that close to the Turks over there, how they didn't pick up the fact that the Turks had not only dug their trenches, but had covered them over. They cut the trees down, probably a little bit smaller than that, around about 9-inch logs, and covered the top of their trenches with logs. The Australians didn't realise that. The second thing, and I'll now go back to the artillery, it was provided mainly from British warships, in particular one, HMS Bashanti, which was out off the beachhead, and it was directing artillery fire onto this position. Some early shells, and if they managed to get a direct hit on the Turkish trenches, they didn't get too many, but they did get some, and the shells would explode. The timber logs, because they were still green, would shatter, and the splinters caused quite a number of Turkish casualties.
This success involved the capture of 300 metres of the front line to a depth of 150 metres. It was perhaps the most ferocious fight of the whole campaign, where Australians won 7 Victoria Crosses. It cost the lives of nearly 2,300 Australians.
Quinn's Post was the most easterly position held at Anzac for the duration of the occupation. The resupply to the troops at Quinn's occurred on the 30th of April, that's 5 days after the landing. This shows the level of logistic planning and organisation that had occurred.
Quinn's Post was one of the most dangerous places at Anzac, and equally most important, as the Turks were only a few metres away in their trenches, and if they had been able to capture Quinn's, the whole Anzac area would have been lost. Named after Major Hugh Quinn of 15 Battalion, his company set up the position at the head of Monash Valley. It was possibly the most dangerous position held by Australians in any wars, as it was exposed on two sides and open to aimed fire from the rear, with the front lines being only 10 metres apart. Position was held, and Lieutenant Colonel William Malone, New Zealand Wellington Battalion, took over the position in June and transformed it into something which, if never safe, was moderately habitable. Behind me is a tree that was grown from the seeds taken from the pine trees at Lone Pine. Following the campaign, when the soldiers returned home, many of them brought seeds with them, and those seeds were germinated in farms in Victoria and New South Wales and found their way to those properties. This particular tree is one of the few that remained here, and there is another one further down in the park. This is a place of remembrance. We must never forget those who volunteered to go overseas to fight for their country, and many who did not return. They are either in a Commonwealth War Graves cemetery or in an unnamed grave, lest we forget.